Hi, my name is Evan Fraser, and I'm the director of the Errol Food Institute at the University of Guelph, where I'm also a professor of geography. I spend a lot of time thinking about one of the world's biggest challenges, how to sustainably, equitably, nutritiously feed the world's growing population. The statistics are actually quite scary. Over the next 50 years, the farmers of this world are going to have to produce as much food as they have over the last 10,000 years combined. At the same time, we are going to have to deal with climate change and other major environmental problems. But consider this. We actually already produce enough food for us all to have a full diet. But this food is so badly distributed that close to 2 billion people are either overweight or obese, while about 800 million people remain undernourished. We also waste about a third of the world's food. And this brings me to our latest project, Feeding 9 Billion, the card game. In this card game, players take the role of an imaginary country that has to produce enough food to feed its population. When you get the game, you will have to sort the cards out. First, pull out the asset cards and put them to the side. Next, find the yellow event cards. Then, pull out the four round cards and make sure these are in order with round one at the top. Shuffle the resource cards and deal each player 10. Make sure you have a copy of the rules handy and that you've printed up the score sheet. These are all available on our website. The goal of the game is to feed your country by producing the amount of food listed on the round cards. In round 1, you need 16 food. In round 2, 18, and so on. The rising amount of food you have to produce reflects population growth in the real world. Food is produced by making sets of cards. For instance, if at the end of the round you have played 3 cereal cards, then you produce 6 food, and this is noted at the bottom of each card. For every 2 fat and oil cards you have, you produce 5 food, etc. Gameplay works like this. Everyone begins by looking at the 10 cards they have in their hand and simultaneously selecting one and playing it face up. Everyone takes their remaining 9 cards and passes these cards to the left so that now you have an entirely new set of cards in your hand. Everyone now plays a second card and passes the remaining cards to the left. And this continues until everyone has played 10 cards. By having the right sets of cards played in front of you at the end of the round, you produce the food your population needs. You will notice that there are 3 cards that don't produce food. These are luxury cards, extra labor cards, and the food processing plant cards. The luxury cards are simple. The player with the most luxuries at the end of the round gains $2, while the player with the least loses $1. You can use this money to buy technology or assets. I'll explain this in a second. You play the extra labor cards just like any other card, and if you have one in front of you, it acts as if you have imported migrant labor to work in your food system. This means that during a subsequent turn, you can pick the extra labor card up and put it back in your hand and then simultaneously play 2 other cards, like this. The food processing plant is most useful if you can play it early in the round. If you have already played a food processing plant, the next time you play a perishable food item, such as a vegetable, a dairy, or a fruit card, you play that card on top of the food processing plant. The food processing plant helps these perishable items last longer, and at the end of the round, a perishable item card that is played onto a food processing plant counts triple its base score. For instance, dairy cards count 3 food, but when played onto a food processing plant, they produce 9. Each food processing plant can only be used once, and the food processing plant has to be played before the perishable card to work. At the end of the round, if the players wish, they can trade cards to help make sets and produce food or raise money. After trading is finished, everyone adds up the total amount of food and money they have earned and makes note of this on the scorecard. Each player should then determine if they've produced enough food for each round. So in round 1, every player needs 16 food. If they fail to produce enough food, they should note this on the scorecard. If players have surplus food or money, they can use these to buy agricultural technology or assets. In this game, there are 3 different kinds of agricultural asset a player can invest in: green, blue, and red. Each asset card has a cost. For instance, this green card represents investing in what's called integrated pest management, or ecological ways of trying to combat agricultural pests. It costs one food and $1. It pays to specialize on one kind of asset, and if you have more than one asset card of a specific color, then you unlock the higher level benefits. For example, a player who has purchased two of the green cards would enjoy the second level of benefit for both cards. Buying assets works like this. At the end of each round, shuffle the asset cards and deal five face up. Starting with the player who had produced the most amount of food in the previous round, that player can look at the five cards that have been laid out and buy any they can afford using their surplus food or money. As cards are purchased, replace them with a new card from the asset deck. Continue in this way until all players have had a chance to purchase cards. These assets are now part of the player's country and last for the rest of the game. Lastly, the world isn't always a nice place, so starting at the beginning of round two, deal one event card face up. These events affect all players as noted on the card. As the game goes on, events get worse, and this simulates things like climate change that are expected to worsen over time. For instance, a drought in round two has less of an impact than a drought in round four. If you want to make the game trickier, turn the event card over about halfway through the round, after people have played about five cards. This will simulate a sudden or surprise event, and then you can see how much harder it is to play the game that way. At the end of playing four rounds, total up the number of scores everyone's got and figure out who wins. More importantly than figuring out who wins, however, it's important to reflect on what you've learned. Maybe consider the following questions. Is it easier for people to obtain food security when they trade cards with each other? Or is it more difficult? Is it harder to play the game when a sudden event surprises people halfway through, or when you can plan for things coming in advance? This game focuses on producing enough food, but doesn't really talk about waste, food distribution, or whether the food we're producing is nutritious. Maybe you could do some research and figure out these issues for yourself and come to your own conclusions about the best strategies for feeding the world's growing population. All of these questions and further ideas for research are actually listed on our website, and we really encourage you to go and check these out. But mostly, we really hope you have fun. And please, let us know how you've made out. Once again, my name is Evan Fraser, and I'm the director of the Errol Food Institute at the University of Guelph, and you can follow me on Twitter at Feeding 9 Billion. Thanks very much.